And now, from Metro East Community Media, it's The Duck That Came In From the Cold. Brought to you by Dermaspackle's Holistic Weed and Feed Cooperative, now with 4 locations to serve you. And now, let's look in on the happy couple.
You must be exhausted, May. A nice bath would help.
Bath? Honey, do you think that's such a good idea?
I'd love a bath.
Of course it's a good idea.
Lovely, then. See you 2 lovebirds tomorrow.
No, sleep in. We have the next 2 weeks to catch up.
Oh, Beth. Oh, she must have turned on the water for a bath. Always a considerate one.
Why would I do that?
Beth, there's a you-know-what in the bathtub?
Magical ring?
Yes, it is. And you should have told her.
Beth! You didn't tell me you had a pet!
Sorry, Meg. We don't think of him as a pet.
What's he doing in your bathtub?
That's where he hangs out.
You gave up your bathtub to a duck?
He's not just any duck.
What's that supposed to mean?
What Beth is trying to say.
Oh,
is...
no explanation necessary. But where do I put him so I can take a bath?
Well, you see, that's the thing.
That's where he lives.
What do you do when you want to take a bath?
Take a bath.
Where does the duck go?
The duck doesn't go anywhere.
But it has to go somewhere.
Why should the duck be anywhere but in its natural habitat?
Beth, its natural habitat is outside, in the wetlands, in the water.
Do you know how cold it is out there?
Ducks have goose down feathers for that.
Not this duck.
What do you mean, not this duck?
Well, he lost most of his goose down and doesn't have any protection against the cold.
She's become a bit of an expert on ducks.
None of my pets survived when I was growing up.
She spent a lot of time in therapy over this.
Oh, you spent time in therapy over dead pets?
But they were my dead pets. And now I have a live duck.
He survived for quite some time up there. Almost 2 years.
He's been in your bathtub for 2 years?
We've had some very cold winters here in California.
Very cold. You know, our heating bill has just about tripled.
In California?
Global warming, the price of heating fuel, who knows?
I love my duck, Meg.
Your duck?
I've always wanted a duck, since we had those little baby ducklings, remember?
Oh, the ones your mother sold to a farmer.
So how long do you think those ducks lived?
I don't know.
That farmer fattened them up and then he ate them.
Oh, so you're doing what, penance?
I miss those ducklings. They were so cute.
You know, we tried to get him to come down to the dinner table, but he wouldn't.
I wonder why.
Stairs are awkward from Malcolm.
He quacks like that when we call him by his name.
We called him a lot of different names.
Until he responded to Malcolm.
Oh, Meg, we're so excited Malcolm found his name.
That way, we could stop calling him names that weren't, well, his.
We can't wait for the twins to play with him.
What twins?
You didn't tell her?
Do you think this is the right time and place?
She's already seen the duck.
You're right as always, Henry. We're expecting twins.
We just found out. Now Malcolm will have playmates.
Couldn't you just get another duck?
We tried that. Malcolm ate it.
It was a mess to clean up. We think the other duck started.
They fought over the small rubber ducky.
But Malcolm will be fine with the twins.
How do you know?
I know this duck, Meg. Wouldn't hurt my babies. Besides
what?
Malcolm and I have had lots of talks.
Oh, about what?
You name it, we've had it.
He's quite intellectual for a duck.
Sorry, Malcolm. We forget sometimes.
He accepts our apology.
You understand what he's saying?
We had to take a crash course.
Oh, what with intonation and pitch. Those quacks can be so guttural.
Okay, you two, that's enough.
But, Malcolm, honey, we just took a bath today.
You understand him?
Oh, she's gotten really good at this. Way better than me. And I was raised on a farm.
Quacked that all this talk about him makes him lonely for his real family.
He had a family?
A large one, apparently. 12 siblings. And parents, of
course. Happened? Oh, God. I can't believe I just asked about a duck.
You hurt his feelings, Meg.
He's gotten more sensitive as he's gotten older.
We think he'll be a good teacher for the twins.
You plan on letting him play in the tub?
We're planning the birth in the tub.
We are so excited. Aren't we, Malcolm?
We've been teaching him how to breathe so we can help Beth with her contractions.
You'll make medical history, won't you, Malcolm? He's not so sure he wants to be in the spotlight.
Okay, you two. I've heard enough.
Oh, Meg. Malcolm is so disappointed.
If I understood that last series of quacks, he was helping?
I think that last quack, was hoping.
Oh, of course. Hoping.
Hoping what?
That you would take a bath with Malcolm.
Take a bath with a duck.
He's not just any duck, Meg. He's our duck. He's family, just like you.
Oh, well, I don't know.
About what?
Well, avian flu, for one thing.
He's had all his shots.
He's had
his. And we got him a flu vaccine.
We got him health insurance through the local farm co-op.
He's healthier than the U.S. economy. Oh, he's a good duck, Meg.
He won't hurt you.
In fact, we've noticed a peculiar thing.
Did you see under his wing?
Malcolm's getting new feathers. Aren't those new, Malcolm?
He says they're new.
Oh, Malcolm, you're growing new feathers.
We know what you're thinking, Malcolm.
You do?
He's thinking, once I have new feathers, you'll throw me back out into the cold.
He is?
Well, sure he is, wouldn't you?
I don't know.
Sure you would, Meg.
You have a home here for as long as you want, Malcolm.
And you know how much the twins are looking forward to playing with you. I think how much we can get out once they're born.
You plan on leaving the twins alone with the duck?
You've hurt his feelings again, Meg.
Say you're sorry.
To a duck?
To our duck. Your family, Meg, just like Malcolm. Now say you're sorry.
Beth?
Yes, Meg, honey?
If I take a bath...
Oh, will you?
That would mean so much to us.
Okay, I said if.
Okay, if you took a bath with Malcolm.
Does that mean he wants me to?
Oh, very much, Meg.
He's dying for you to take a bath with him.
Oh, is there anything I should know about... the duck? Well, does he bite?
Oh, nary a pinch.
Does he want me to talk to him because...
It's just that he's lonely, Meg. He'd love the company.
Does that mean what I think it means?
See how easy it is to understand him?
What does that mean?
He's happy. Very happy that you've accepted his invitation.
We'll leave you two to your bed.
There are extra towels in the cabinet, just in case.
In case what?
Malcolm likes to splash a lot. Oh, he says not to worry. It's quite a relaxing experience.
It's changed our perspective on quite a few things.
In what way?
Well, aren't Henry and I more relaxed than when you last visited?
Well, I did notice.
I've become a teetotaler, and Beth here has stopped her compulsive eating.
I feel so light, even with the twins.
What would you like to change, Meg?
Change?
About yourself. Well, there must be something you want to change about yourself.
Well, I could think of a few
Malcolm
things.
Malcolm will help with that.
He will?
You must be exhausted.
Tired to the bone.
Malcolm will help with that, too. He'll drain it all away.
I didn't get that, Malcolm.
He said he wants your word that you won't make waves.
Why's that?
Malcolm gets seasick.
In a bathtub?
He tolerates our quirkinesses, and we tolerate his, don't we, Malcolm?
Is there anything else I should know before
Malcolm is a great back scrubber, aren't you, Malcolm?
Well, we'll leave you two to get acquainted.
Good night, Meg. Night, Malcolm. Sweet dreams.
Malcolm?
Map, 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 map.
I'm going to put my foot in first.
Map, 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 map.
Oh, that feels nice. There's lavender in the water, isn't there?
Map, 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 map.
Lavender always relaxes me.
Map, 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 map.
I don't understand what you're quacking.
Ma, 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 ma.
Oh, that feels nice. Ma. Oh, that's just the spot. Ma. How did you? Ma.
Christ, Anthony, this place is deader than Bin Laden's singing career.
Well, maybe that's why they're closing the place down.
It's a shame.
What? Why? This place is a hole-in-the-wall dive.
Why do you hang out here 4 days a week?
More like 6 days a week.
Cheap drinks.
I buy most your drinks!
Well, the ones you don't buy are cheap. And besides, where else can I find such rewarding and stimulating company? You reading about?
It says here that dogs use their sense of smell like humans use their eyesight. Well, dogs have up to 500 million scent detecting cells in their brain. Humans have over 300.
Why is that funny?
Because all they do is they smell each other's asses.
Yep, I'll be glad when this place is a parking lot.
You know, this place might be a dive bar, but it's my dive bar. All right, I was knee-deep in the blood and the muck. They owe me a place where I can park my old ass and chain smoke while drinking cheap beer.
You were knee-deep in the blood and the muck, huh? You fell out of your truck first month in Iraq and hurt your back bad enough to get sent home.
Okay, it was during a mortar attack, and at least I was in the military. This place is for men and women who have fought in a foreign war. You never spent a day in uniform.
You see a dive bar? I see tradition. All right, an organization founded in 1898 by enlisted men to fight for the rights of the men and women who put their lives on the line for democracy. Tradition! Now, look, this is an organization that fought for war widows and orphans when no one else would, retrained injured vets, found them homes, influenced policy.
Sure, sure. Maybe that's how they started off. But now, they're just dive bars for rusty old war vets.
Dive bars where I can park my old ass, chain smoke while drinking beer, and listen to a pain in the ass pogue like
PBR then?
Sorry? Does Reagan have his own airport? What?
Sergeant Major?
25 years in the U.S. infantry should count for something, right? They still call a doctor when he retires.
You, Gil? Another?
Nah, Tony. I'm all right.
Anthony.
My name is Anthony.
You know, Barry, you really should change up your verbiage.
You, sir, are a saint.
That's what they tell me.
Change up my what?
Verbiage. Your diction, the way you talk. You've been using these same Cold War phrases for 20 years now.
Maybe that's why you have no luck with the ladies.
Yeah. I don't get laid because I hang out with you and at the BFW at 2 in the afternoon.
4:15.
Christ, Barry. Hanging out with me is all you've really got going on.
Well, that's not true, Gil, because I also have a mean need to take a piss. Oh, Christ. All right, hold on a second.
Now what are you reading about?
Nothing.
Nothing, huh?
Excuse us, gentlemen. Could you tell us which way to the Siam Society?
It's a Thai food restaurant.
Thai, huh? Spicy!
Sure. It would be our absolute pleasure to help you out. Siam Society, isn't that a few blocks up, big man? You'll have to forgive our friend here. He is absolutely fascinated by nothing. But when my esteemed colleague returns, I'm sure he would be more than happy to tell you the location of your Thai food restaurant.
Hey, wait a sec. Haven't I seen you before somewhere?
Me? Well, I was interviewed by the Portland Tribune for their article about the suicide rate of Iraqi war vets. Obviously didn't kill myself, but I didn't even know what it's about until they published my picture on the front page. My whole family called me that week.
No, not you. You, I know I've seen you before.
I've driven up Division lately.
Yeah, you're that Gamblers Anonymous guy in that billboard on 112th and Division.
Guilty.
Do you have to go to meetings or something?
No, I'm an actor slash model. You might have seen me on television, too. I just did a national spot about 6 months ago that I think is still airing.
Here comes the commercial.
Be responsible. When you feel an outbreak coming on, use Herpinex. Herpinex clears up to 84% of all outbreaks within the first 48 hours. Herpinex. Don't be next. Use Herpinex. The one physicians trust.
Holy Christ, that was you? Awesome! Honey, this is the Herpinex.
Well, sure, you should. You would be great. Listen, I've been in the business a long time, kid.
A very long time.
And I can tell you would be a star. I mean, just look at that smile. Yep, no denying it. You remind me of a young Robert Mitchum.
Who?
What do you think?
A dead ringer, Robert Mitchum.
think so. Hey, let me buy you a drink. What are you?
Mirror Pond with a Cuervo shooter.
Thank you very much.
Let's make a toast. We're gonna need a couple more shots over here, big man. To the death of Marlon Brando. May his fat ass burn in hell.
I don't drink hard alcohol.
Oh, I'm sorry for thinking that you did. Do you mind if I...
Oh, no, go ahead.
I met him, you know.
Robert Mitchum.
Marlon Brando.
Summer 1976. I had just landed the part of Colonel Kurtz's Green Beret right-hand man in Apocalypse Now. The role of a lifetime.
Role of a lifetime.
Well, that's how I met Barry over here. I was doing research for the part, and Barry was a decorated soldier.
Not so decorated yet. I just joined.
Well, you did do a tour in Vietnam.
I was 15 when Vietnam ended.
Huh. Guy stayed just three huts up from Francis Ford Coppola, or Frankie, as his friends called him.
You never called him that.
I don't remember Kurtz having a sidekick in Apocalypse.
You're right, and there's a story behind that. A very long and funny story.
He called Brando a fat ass, and they gave the role to Dennis Hopper.
God damn it, Barry! It's a lot better when I tell it.
That's very sad, but we really should be
going. You know, I didn't need that part, though. I guest starred on Cheers. I've had recurring roles. I've done commercials. I even wrote a pilot that was almost picked up by Fox. But I had to get out of Hollywood. I mean, that place is a shark tank.
Shark tank.
And I've made a pretty decent career for myself up here in Stumptown. I was offender number one in a sexual discrimination video at Nike. They had to show that to all of their employees worldwide.
Worldwide?
There's probably more people working over at Nike than ever saw Apocalypse Now. They even dubbed it in Malaysian.
Bet you Brando was never dubbed in Malaysian.
We really should be going.
Check, please.
You think that's cool? You really haven't heard anything yet. Barry here is a war hero. Well, that's why we're here at the VFW. He's got a ton of stories. Tell him a story.
Okay, so there I am. Knee-deep in grenade pins. I got nothing but a bayonet and a P-51 cannon.
He served in Iraq and was wounded. He has a Purple Heart.
You want to see the scar?
No, I really don't, but thank you for your service.
Well, that was wrong as two boys kissing in a church on Christmas under a crucifix.
What?
You know what I'm talking about.
Hey, he offered to buy the drinks, okay? I didn't take advantage of anyone. And you saw how they were dressed. I mean, they weren't going to miss a couple of bucks.
$31.20.
You really should change the way you talk. Don't ask, don't tell is over, man. Gays have the right to kiss where and when they
you
want.
You jackass! I'm pissed off because they bought you all the drinks because you had hemorrhoids and they passed right over the war hero.
You're not really a war hero. You weren't even a sergeant major.
You didn't really have hemorrhoids.
Herpes.
Whatever. What are you reading about now?
Oh. It says here the top 10 list of fears for humans. Death is only number 7.
It's number 6.
Spiders.
What's number 1?
Change.
I hope you enjoyed that. And I am sitting here with both playwrights, Barbara Genovese, who wrote The Duck Who Came In From the Cold, and Sean Davis, writer of The Quixote Club. Thank you. So this has been quite a long journey for both of you, I would imagine, and for me as well. But please, tell me how you got from the first words on the page to here, in a summary, if you would.
You can go first.
Well, The Quixote Club was actually a short story that was published in a Portland State literary journal called Pathos Magazine. And I loved it. It was only like 4 or 5 pages. And then a couple of years later, I thought, let's make a short film out of it. So actually, you were the director on that. We had that Quixote Club curse, I guess. We shot the first day, and then the second day, the actors call me up, like, do I really have to come in today? I'm hungover, or the location didn't open for a long time. And then, so we passed it on, and then you started doing this great thing. And you called and said, hey, can I use that script as an example? I'm like, yeah, let's do it, you know? So, and that's how it happened. You had already had a whole season, and then I finally got a slot, so it's been so popular. So I really appreciate you doing this. Thanks a lot.
Oh, you're welcome. And I've been witness to part of the evolution of Quixote Club.
So the script's changed a lot, right?
It's changed a lot. I like the way it is now.
Well, I wrote it when you can still smoke in bars, but so those were vapor cigarettes that we had. But so now you can't anymore. So
could you talk just a little bit about how the script has changed from the earlier drafts?
Yeah, I mean, it's evolved. It's just the actors are. I have to thank Robert and Maya and Todd and Josh and Tim and Caitlin. Everybody's just. I wasn't prepared to see how they turned the characters into real people and how it just worked so well. It was really amazing. And so as it went, Robert's like, well, what if we make this character this way and can we do this? And they were great because I'd go to all the rehearsals. I think the writer should go to all the rehearsals and do rewrites. I mean, we had 8 revisions total, and it was just so that's the whole evolution of them making the characters their own and kind of changing it. And it ended up looking like it was like I did it, but it wasn't really me at all. It was these guys.
And Barbara, with The Duck Who Came In From the Cold, it had another title, didn't it?
No, that was the original title.
Genovese the Duck? It wasn't called that.
No.
Oh. I just remember an email from you that said that.
Oh, yeah. I was being funny.
Oh.
I worked on KBOO's The Sudden Radio Project for 5 years, and each month I produced at least one script, and this was one of them. So it hasn't changed, except that the actors gave life to the words.
And so, well, the short play format, I mean, fortunately, being in Portland, we have a lot of opportunities to present short plays because someone's already, some startup upstart companies are already producing a 10-minute play festival. What about the short play attracts either of you?
Well, I don't just write short plays. I write full lengths also. But for radio, I had to limit myself to about 10 to 15 pages. So it forced me to say what I needed to say in a prescribed amount of time. So that was a good discipline to learn that.
For me, it was my experience with trying to do short films. These actors don't have very long attention spans. So you just make it really short for them. No offense, guys. No, it was a lot of fun, you know. Trying to put a little story arc or... you can't really do a story arc, but like a theme to one of those short films. You know, this one was supposed to be Don Quixote and dreams, and they didn't follow, but I don't know. It was a lot of fun trying to pack it all into a little spot.
So what I'm hearing is that, and I've written short plays myself, is that it's an economy of language. You have to force yourself to really create a whole world in a very constricted amount of time.
Oh, yeah, comedy is so hard, but... trying to do it like all in that compact, you're challenging yourself.
Right, and trimming out all the fat. I remember just going over and over and over and making sure that anything that didn't need to be there wasn't there, because the ear picks up very quickly. So I didn't want people who were listening to have to labor or stop and think. I wanted it to flow very smoothly from one idea to another.
And did you guys still laugh at your own lines?
Oh, God, hysterically, I couldn't believe it.
I laugh harder when no one else laughs, I think. Like, that was so fun. You guys missed it. Joke's on me. Yeah, we had a blast. It was a lot of fun.
And now I have to ask, in particular, why the duck in the bathtub? Why did that come to you? Where did that come from?
I've been thinking about that. So it's true, in the house that I grew up in, no animals survived. I was lucky I survived. The animals didn't. They fared much worse than I did. So writing is a process of reclaiming. So this was a chance to take back something that had been taken from me, which was no pet survived in my house. And I also live on 35 acres of protected wetlands, and there are critters out there. And I swear to God, the duck changes. There are ducks on the pond, and their intonations change. It's never the same thing. And before that, I thought ducks quacked, you know, on one sort of one note Johnny's, but they're variations, and I just got to listening to it and imagining it coming into my house. It was very satisfying.
So did you actually record them, or did you just take mental notes?
No, I just listened.
He did a great job quacking too.
Yeah, wasn't he? They all left. All my actors left.
Oh, did they? Oh, yeah. Really? Oh, yeah. We're gonna do bows afterward. I can't tell them that.
They left. We'll have to, you know, find their phantasms that are left in the energy plasma around the studio.
I wrote the Quixote Club. Well, Maya and I have put together a small, we're going for a nonprofit status called A Rock or Something Productions, and we're trying to get returning veterans into the arts, you know, stage, writing, music, fine arts, everything. So it just made a whole lot of sense. You know, everybody, except for Caitlin, we always do this to her, sorry. Everybody up here was a veteran, you know, myself, Archie is a veteran, you know, so. I think you go to a play and you'll say, hey, that was pretty good for a bunch of veterans, but actually what they did an amazing job. I think it was just pretty good, you know, it was a good play. So, and plus, I was actually on the cover of the Portland Tribune. It says Suicide Vet. I have it around here somewhere, but my whole family called me that week.
I'm sure. Is that when we were holding the rifle?
No, it was just me staring off blankly. They didn't tell me what it was about.
And there are at least two, maybe three members of the crew that are also veterans too, to me. So.
No, we met. I had the funniest story. Who was about? They thought he was dead, and he came home and surprised his wife and his buddy. It's great. So, you know, you get a bunch of vets together. They just start telling stories. I love it. It's great. Yeah.
Well, I have more writer questions for you.
Oh, good.
Why do you write? Why bother? I mean,
why not?
How does it make you feel? What do you get out of it? What do you want to happen to it?
It happens to me. The words come to me. There are times that I try to turn it off, but it gets me up in the middle of the night. When a story wants to be told, it wants to be told, and there's no way that you can stop it. So what I find myself doing is being in service of what's coming through, what I'm hearing, what I've stepped out of the way for, so that it can have a voice.
Enjoy.
I write, similar. I mean, there are stories out there that I think that need to be told. I mean, I think it's bigger than me. I think just the stories. Really, that's what we're trying to do, going back to the veterans thing, but getting them to be able to write and tell their experiences, because it's really a great experience for me to get, I don't know, those demons out, but just to get the story out and just working through certain things. That's something I really hope to share with other people. You know, I think it's bigger than you. I'm sure you write, right?
Yes, sure.
Asking me, why do you write?
Because I like it. Well, then you found, we're speaking as writers, that characters speak up, mm-hmm. and maybe you have you go in a go in a direction that the character or even the story is resistant to, and you end up back on that road.
Oh yeah.
And it's amazing who shows up, isn't it?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Or who decides they want a bigger part in the right. story. And, wow, okay. Listen to right. you. Yeah, that's great.
And where?
Well, it's also a chance to make the world anew the way that you want it, to recreate an experience and to play God, in a sense. You get to create a world that's all of you, that's all yours. No one can take it away from you. But there are risks that come with that, aren't there? Because once you, it's like the movie Field of Dreams, right? If you build it, he will come. Well, a lot of unexpected things happened in that movie, didn't it? And I think the same is true with writing. You open, you surrender to it, and then kind of hang out with what happens and what comes through.
And how do you know when you're finished?
I stop editing. I mean, seriously editing. When I finish, I'll edit and edit and edit and edit and edit. And then something just says, all right, that's it. I don't want to muck with it anymore. I think it's pretty good. I could probably change a little here, but it's good enough right now. I feel comfortable putting that out into the world. And I take a lot of time with my work. I don't just throw up on the page and then subject other people to it. I sit with it, and I sometimes put stories away for 10 years at a time before I will go back and touch it, because I'm not ready to deal with what came out and to take it to the next step. So I'm very careful and cautious that way.
I don't know. I mean, when's it done? It was done when I published it in that magazine, and then it was done when we made it into a movie. I always keep changing it. So I guess Fade to Black is done until the next thing happens.
And I believe working on some questions from the audience. So I have a couple more. Uh-huh. Why theater?
To me, it's the greatest instant feedback for a writer, you know, getting to gauge what people are watching and how they react to it. Unless I'm like sitting next to somebody as they're reading them a story, but then they might be obligated to laugh, you know. So in a theater, if I'm in the back row, they don't know that I'm there, and you know, I can see. So it's great. Yeah, I love it. I have to do some more of it, definitely.
Mm. So why theater? Okay, don't cry. But when I was growing up and I was doing artwork, my mother used to make me walk my artwork out to the trash, so that was a nix on the artwork. Theater was the only place where she couldn't touch me, so I started out as an actor on the other side of the lights, and then made my way back to the other side and found my writing voice, so that's why theater.
And stepping back, so you finished the play, and you're happy with it, no more rewrites, it's good. And then it goes into rehearsals. And you see, and what happens then? Do you see things that you, maybe I need to change that?
Oh, definitely. You know, like I said, we had 8 revisions of this play. I think every writer should go to as many rehearsals as possible and work as closely as Robert and I worked together, because he would have these great ideas about these characters, and, you know, how much thought I put in it. I called Timmy's character Young Man and Caitlin Young Woman, but Robert actually gave him histories and everything. And so I see that, and I'm like, all right, he wants her to be stronger, and then I'll rewrite it. So the revision process, I think that should go on as long as it can.
Barbara, what changed for you once you saw the play on stage?
Well, the actors gave voice to it, because before that I had just heard it in my head, and we had recorded it at KABU. But once an actor gets a hold of it, they bring their history and their inventiveness and their creativity to it. And to hear the duck, we roared every time he opened his beak. So they expanded beyond what I could have dreamed of, because once chemistry starts working, and Sharon, who also left, cast just the right people, some magic happens, and you live to see that magic happen.
Well, we were cracking up in the control room during both plays. Oh. Watching both plays. So.
Well, the duck was pretty good. Though.
Yeah, the duck was great. Do we have questions now? So we have some questions from the audience, from our studio audience. Thank you. Was it Sean? This is for Sean. Was it difficult to find vets who wanted to act or get involved?
No, you know, you'd think, no, I mean, not at all. After finding Maya, I worked with Josh, and I said, hey, Josh, I'm doing this thing. And it's more like, actually, I outranked Josh and Timmy so at one time, so I could just make them do it. No, they were interested, you know. I just tell them, hey, we're doing a play, and like, yeah, I want to get into that. You know, Josh, I don't think Tim or Josh had acted since high school, and it was just another outlet, so it was a lot of fun.
And this is for Sean again. How do you hope this will help vets?
Well, like I was saying, for me, writing about the incidents or whatever had happened, it really helps. You know, you get it out there because it's buried inside of you and you get it out. But as far as like acting go, I mean, Maya went across the country doing the telling. And, you know, you don't get like this feeling like, oh, wow, it's over now. But it's out there and it's not like you're reliving it, but you're expressing it, you know. And it gives, like Josh was telling me the other day, sorry, Josh, but he's like, this is awesome because if I wasn't doing this, I'd be on the couch drinking tonight, you know. And so then that's what I really want to happen. Because I believe that people need an extended family, and veterans have an extended family to an extent, but when they come back, a lot of us just go dive into the bottle. But like, if you have this going on, so, you know, healthy activities in that extended family, that'll really help them out. So that's how I hope it'll help.
Now, Barbara, we haven't talked about your connection to veterans and the VA.
I worked at the VA on a project, and they have a program called Pathways, and I applied. I designed a creative arts writing circle for veterans with PTSD, taught a class, and Sean and I were talking about this, so I think we're going to team up later and try to get that going again.
Awesome.
Because the last assignment I gave the vets was to write a haiku, which is a very stylized form of Japanese writing, and they, to this day, I can't write a haiku. One gentleman in the class self-published a book that he wanted to sell at the Wall in Washington, D.C. Some of the vets had never written about the Vietnam War, if you can wrap your mind around that. So it was an extraordinary process to create a safe space for them to feel comfortable to express whatever they needed to express. And sometimes in a roundabout way, which got them closer to expressing what maybe didn't come out in the class, but at some point it will express itself, I believe. You just have to start it. It's that old, if you build it, he will come. One thing follows another.
Well, we have another question for both of you. It is, do you have a regular writing practice, and what is it?
Well, one of the things I do is I write down my dreams, so that's a regular practice. When a story is ready to come out, it makes itself known, and I know what that is. It's like having a kid at your side that wants attention. You just know when it's ready to start. And before that, a lot of it is just thinking inside and giving it time to prepare and articulate itself.
Did you dream about the deck?
What?
Did you dream about the deck?
You know, I'm not sure how that came about. When I worked for KABU, I know every month I set myself, I said I'm going to write a script, and I'd sit down and whatever came out, and that month it was the duck's turn.
I'm an editor on Silk Road Magazine's Pacific University's Lit Magazine. We have our own Hebrews Press. You know, we do films. I have a 2-year-old, a wife, a full-time job, so a writing practice. I try to get up like at 5 o'clock or 5:30 in the mornings before I go to work to write for 2 hours. But you just squeeze it in, like you said. You know, when you're writing, you have to get it out, so it comes out in certain places. You know, maybe I slack at work too much. I don't know.
But it works. You find a time, way, yeah. Don't you? Yeah. Because it has to. I don't know about you, but if I don't, I get sick. So I don't want to pay that price. Yeah. So I figure out a way to do it. And oftentimes it's getting up, just setting the alarm and getting up a little earlier. And I write when my editor's asleep. So
I write in the late hours when it's all quiet and there's not a lot of.
Yeah, our daughter does not go to sleep. So that doesn't work. She's a battery.
All right. Well, if that's all the questions from the audience, I'd like to wrap this up by thanking you both very much for.
Hey, thanks a lot for the opportunity.
Thank you, Sean Davis and Barbara Genovese. Thank you. Thank you.
And
the crew. And your remaining cast and directors, if they would come up and take a big bow.